the people who run this economy are thinking. Not that they're necessarily right or wrong, but you have to get an idea of what they're talking about and what they're thinking. And then on the third page, what we have done is broken down to you the schematic of what happened to South Korea in particular, but what happens to all of the countries now in the IMF system. And what I would like to do for 5 minutes is to see if I can take the first page and schematically put it down on this blackboard. If I have some chalk, I'm going to write on this one until we get it here. Because what I want to do is we want to go over it schematically so we can follow it. And the purpose of this is just to expose you to some information so that we can get an idea of what it is we're dealing with. And as we begin to analyze this, we can begin to see those pieces of information that are needed by us so that we can better understand what is going on around us. And then we're going to discuss it. And what I'd like to do is present the material to you. And after presenting the material, then we can have a question and answer period around it, and maybe we can expand on it in a little more detail there. And what this is a schematic that reflects what actually has happened and what is happening. This is not a schematic that I put together from some hypothetical theory or formula that I want to work out of, and therefore this is what he says. Now, in order to look at the world economic order, let's look at the first page, and you notice on your first page in your upper left-hand corner there's some information here. And what does it say? It says raw materials, labor, and technology. Because it is raw materials, labor, and technology that make a community run, makes a country run, and make the world run. Stock and bonds and futures and all these derivatives don't make the world run. You have to have human beings digging the soil, planting crops, harvesting the crops, digging up mines, converting metal from the oxides into metal, and making things. So that's what makes the world run. That's why we start with raw material, labor, and technology. Then let's go to number one. Number one is colonialism. In order for you to understand what is happening to you or the so-called world economic order today, we got to go back at least 500 years minimum. And in that 500 years, we're going to deal with colonialism. And if you notice, colonialism is noted here. And we put an arbitrary date of 1500 to 1945. And that's label number one. You notice number two is labeled what? Raw materials, labor, and technology. Why do we indicate that? Because of colonialism, the ability in this case of white people, European, predominantly from Western Europe, England, France, Germany, Spain, and Portugal primarily. These countries, around 1500 to 1945, because of a number of reasons, they were successful in leaving Europe and beginning to conquer and bring other people under their control and taking their land. And in the process of colonialism, to go into a country, to take one's natural resources, to use the labor of one's persons, and to use the technology, it was this process that made what you call the United States, what you call Western Europe, and later Japan, strong economic countries in the 1900s. So let's look at number two, raw materials. They come to America, let's say, they come to Africa, they take your wood, they take your minerals and your food. By bringing these raw materials back to Europe, they're able to now eat well, they're able to build their homes, they're able to build factories. And of course, we know about the labor, the free labor that the Europeans and America use in which to build up this country. African people, you know, in synopsis, built the roads here, they built the levees for the river, they planted the food, they planted the cotton, they harvested the cotton. And why is the raw material and labor important? Because what was the foundation of the so-called Industrial Revolution that you read about in the educational system here? The foundation of the Industrial Revolution is when America and Western Europe begins to so-called build up industrially. And that building up industrially was based on what? The raw materials taken primarily from the Caribbean first and then from Africa. It was fueled by the physical labor of Africans, unskilled labor and skilled labor. Africans, when they went to Africa, they didn't take out unskilled labor. They took out individuals, farmers who knew how to plant corn, who knew how to plant rice, who knew how to plant those agricultural products that you find in the Caribbean. So they would take your labor, skilled and unskilled, and from this skilled labor, they will begin to build America and they will begin to build Europe. So you now know they're taking your raw materials, they got your labor, skilled and unskilled, and your technology. What are some of the foundation of the so-called Industrial Revolution is what? Textiles and chemicals. Well, you know the African people have been weaving all kind of textile products, cloth. So not only have we been weaving it, but we have had in our possession for thousands of years the technology of weaving. All those weaving looms and machines that you find that in the textile mills in America and the textile mills in Europe, they came from Africa. The exact prototype, the exact machines were taken, so when they went and raided, not only did they pull you away, pull your scientists away, pull your people away, but they took your machines. And it was those machines that would go in to make the spinning gin here and all these inventions here. So they transferred from us not only the raw material, not only our physical body and the labor, but they transferred the technology. That technology transfer, primarily from Africa to the Caribbean, America, and Europe, is what started the so-called Industrial Revolution for European and white people, your textile. And we can go back to metallurgy, where the Industrial Revolution was when the Europeans began to learn how to make steel and how to smelt to get aluminum and copper. But you can go back to any part of Africa, West Africa, and you can see where we were smelting iron and brass and copper and tin and silver. Or you can go along the Nile. If you go to the trip with Dr. Ben, you will see where the Africans have worked in gold and silver and copper and bronze and platinum. So it's well documented that those industrial processes in metals that made the Industrial Revolution here came from the continent. The textiles, the textile industry, and all of the technology primarily came. It was the ability to, for 300 or 400 years, to drain from you your labor, your technology, and your resources that made America and Europe what it was. And if you go through the scenario, you would see Lloyd's of London, all of these big insurance houses in America and Europe, and didn't come into existence until after this process has occurred. So that's the foundation. So when you look at Lloyd's of London and Citibank and National Bank and Carnegie, where did the foundation come from? It came from number two. Your raw material, your technology, and your resources used to make Europe or white people in Western Europe strong and powerful. So there's almost nothing that you can look at in America where you can't directly see where it came from this process. And that's why what brings America and Western Europe into 1900, a dominant economic power, dominant military power, relative to the African, the Asians, and the brothers and sisters and others in the Caribbean. So when you're talking about the world economic order, you have to go back at least to that portion of colonialism. That's the foundation of the wealth of Europe and America. We're not going to deal with the white people from Eastern Europe, because those white human beings called Russians went over the Ural Mountains heading west and equally did to those Asians what the Western Europeans did to us. So you had the white people split in two halves. Those you call Western Europeans, English, French, Spanish, Portuguese, German, they left. They conquered what you call America, the Caribbean, and Africa, and the Pacific. But the other half of them, those white Russians, crossed the Ural Mountains from 1300 and began to conquer what is now parts of Pakistan, India, China, and they kill off and exterminated those people in Asia you call Eskimos, Ainus, people of color. That's how Russia got its power and its strength. So you had two parallels. But here we're going to deal with the Western part. So as you begin to, and if you look at the map here, what we're saying is those Europeans from Western Europe came out in this portion and went in this direction. But you also had white people calling themselves Russians who after 1300 began to cross the Ural Mountains. And in the age of conquest, what they were doing to us here, what they did was these white Russians went in and conquered these Asian people
the Iranians, the Pakistanis, the Mongolians, the Aleuts, and others, those white Russians from 1300 to present, conquered Asia. They came out of Asia and they went across and conquered Alaska. And the Russians were trying to almost conquer Hawaii. So you had a dual conquest on both ends. So anyone who tells you that the Soviet Union is your friend, as European, look at the history, you see that's nonsense. Okay, so as we go on, you see the foundation. Now we go to number three. And number three is labeled trilateral. And the trilateral, we just means there are three sides. And since 1900, when white as Europeans got together, they formed different organizations that they needed to project themselves. And the word trilateral just means three sides. And the three sides of the Trilateral Commission, and we'll expand on it later, is United States and Canada is one side. Western Europe is the second side. And they added Japan as the third side. Trilateral Commission was instituted about 1975. And they represent those countries who formerly had colonies and who band together to form colonies, band together to become strong. Let's go back briefly to see who the English are, the Spanish, the English, and the Germans. When you look at the history of Europe, approximately 400 AD, a group of Europeans coming from the northern part of Europe, which you call Scandinavia, Sweden, Denmark, Norway, Finland, and what you call Russia and Denmark. They came down in a series of invasions starting at 400 AD and they smashed the Roman Empire. These invasions continued to push 500 AD, 600, 700, 800, 900, and they kept pushing down into Central Europe. When these groups of people who were beginning this invasion, they're called Germanic people, they will come in and exterminate the Europeans who were presently there, which were primarily Romans and Celts. Those Europeans you call Germanic people, three sets of these German people would go into what is now England or Great Britain. England and Great Britain was previously occupied by a group of Europeans called Celts, who are now survived as the Irish, the Scottish, the Welsh. So those Germans invaded into the, what you call England. The three groups that invaded the German groups are Angles, Saxons, and Jutes. They will come in and invade what you call England and exterminate the Irish or the Celts. Their name will change into Englishmen. And when these Englishmen come to America, the name of these people will change to Americans. So the point that I want to point out to you, and you see this scheme, that Americans are Englishmen. Englishmen are Germans. They're Jutes, Angles, and Saxons, no different than Hitler. So let's clear in your mind about who these Europeans are you call an American. They come from Germany. Two groups went into France, two German groups, the Burgundians and Franks. They exterminated most of the Celts there, and what Africans were there, and they are now called Frenchmen. So Frenchmen are Germans. Another group, two groups, went into northern Italy and northern Spain. They are called the Visigoths and Vandals. Those white English, the white Spanish, and the white Italian, the white from Yugoslavia, they're Germans. Another group of Germans will move to the west. That group is called the Rus, R-U-S. They will comprise your white Russian, your Boris Yeltsins. So let's get a frame of reference historically clear that those Europeans who now you recognize as Englishmen, Americans, Germans, French, Spanish, Italian, Russians, they're all Germans. Racially, they are the same. There's no distinction. So don't mix them up about one of your colonizers is better than the other. Okay. It is these Germans, when they were able to occupy and conquer and control all of Europe, when they were able to kill off the Celts, push the Moors out, push the Arabs out from Yugoslavia, and push the Turks out, and they finally got control of Europe in its entirety, they fought each other from that point. What was the wars that these European, these German tribes fought? We go back 1600, the 30-year war, 100-year war. The Napoleonic Wars in 1800, there was England, France, Russia, and Germany, all cousins fighting each other. That Napoleonic War, they blamed on Napoleon. It was a pan-European war, these Germans fighting among themselves. You go on to the Franco-Prussian War. So all of last century, from 1800 to 1900, was one series of a war in Europe, from one end of Europe to the other. They're killing each other. They continue this intra-ethnic war as World War I. Again, the same group, England, France, Germany, Russia, and they added their cousins in Yugoslavia. That's a pan-African war. A pan-European, pan-Germanic war. They had a little break. They went at it again, World War II. A pan-European war. Germans fighting Germans. It is that wars that they had that made it possible for all people to begin to get independent. Remember, England, Spain, Portugal, England, France, and Germany, and US, they had colonies, right? Each of these countries could hold its colonies under its own structure. But because of the Napoleonic Wars, or those wars in 1800, followed by World War I and II, all of these European countries destroyed themselves to such an extent that none of these European countries could hold on to their colonial structure by themselves. So after World War II, they had to collectivize. They had to sit down together and say, look, we destroyed each other and weakened each other so much that we can't hold on to our colonial structure. We must collectivize our energy as white Germans to continue to control the world. In 1945, those European Germans, called Americans, English, and French primarily, later added on by the Germans, would sit down and say, look, we have to devise a military unit among us Germans to dominate these people of color. So they born NATO. North Atlantic Treaty Organization is an organization of Western European countries band together against the Africans, the Asians, and etc., because they no longer individually could hold a colonial base. They needed a political structure in which they would collectively try to control you. So they formulated the UN. Now they need an international loan shark money scheme to get you. IMF, World Bank.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Bretton Woods, 1945, America's now becoming the dominant country because the Africans are colonized, the Asians are colonized, and Europe is devastated. So United States is calling the shot. So in 1944, United States Germans will call a conference called Bretton Woods in New Hampshire, and they will set up these three organizations. And what I want to do is to read for you briefly a article from Assessment. Just apologize for coming. This is from Al Gore, who is a European environmentalist. And listen to what they're talking about, the Marshall Plan. Immediately after World War II, this is Gore speaking, history, Europe was so completely devastated. I'm quoting from Al Gore's book on the Global Marshall Plan as they review the Marshall Plan. You know what the Marshall Plan is, right? When America will try to help its European cousins. Immediately after World War II, Europe was so completely devastated. Well, you know during World War II, they kill off about 75 million of their own people. They devastated the whole continent. That's not including the 25 million that they killed of themselves in World War I. So between World War I and World War II, they killed 100 million of themselves. Add on to that, another 20 million that they kill of each other in the wars in 1800. And it was so bad in Europe that around 1850, that's when you got your mass migration of white people out of Europe to come to the Caribbean, to Central and South America and America. That's where you get your mass migration. So when you look at The killing of 125 million of their own people within a 100-year period and the mass migration, you understand why Europe is in a negative birth rate. Okay. Immediately after World War II, Europe was so completely devastated that the resumption of normal economic activity was inconceivable. They couldn't feed themselves, house themselves, or fuel. Then in the early spring of 1947, the Soviet Union rejected the U.S. proposal for aiding Germany. So America said, look, can we two cousins get together to help the big cousin? Russia said, no, I'm taking it all. For the recovery of German industry, convincing General George Marshall and President Truman, among others, that the Soviets hoped to capitalize on the prevailing economic distress. The Russians are going to take it all. So Russia, Americans said, no, we're not going to allow that. Not only in Germany, but also in the rest of Europe. They're going to take it all. After much discussion among themselves and study, the U.S. launched the basis for the Marshall Plan, technically known as the European Recovery Program. Of course, you know where they got the resources to do it from. The commonly held view of the Marshall Plan is that it was a bold strategy for helping the nations of Western Europe rebuild and grow strong enough to fend off the spread of capitalism. So they're rebuilding the Europeans. The strategic nature of the plan, which its emphasis on the structural causes of Europeans' inability to lift itself out of its economic, political, and social distress, it was over. The plan concentrated on fixing the bottlenecks, such as a damaged infrastructure, flooded coal mines, and senseless trade barriers. That was impeding the potential growth for each nation's recovery. The European recovery program was sufficiently long-term that it could serve as an overall effect to produce fundamental structural reorientation, not just offer more emergency relief. It was conscientiously designed to change the dynamics of the system to which it extended aid, thus facilitating the emergence of a healthy economy and pattern. That's what the white German American said, we gotta get our people up. Now, this same continent you call Europe, if you look at the scheme, is now one of the trilateral parts. How could a continent that was destroyed to the point that it couldn't feed itself now become part of the world economic scheme where they are holding debt over my head, your head, and the rest of it? What happened? So when we look at the trilateral, it only represents who? Those Western European countries, the former colonial powers. They added Japan on at the end, the United States, joined together using the NATO, the UN, and IMF and World Bank. They established the GATT, General Agreement of Tariff and Trade on how the world economy going to run in 1945, made up by white people. You had nothing to do with it, but you got to follow the rules because who got more guns? They got more guns than you. But because of this fact of World War II primarily, then you, Africans and Asians, began to get a little bit of independence. And that started the movement of independence to African Asian people. And then you know about the different wars and struggles that brought us to the point. So now 1945, these Europeans are band together. They got weapons to get atomic weapons. These European countries control 85, 90, 95% of all the world's resources. So if you wanted to develop as an African country, so if you look down on number four, independent nations, us, non-industrializing. You want to begin to feed yourself. You go to number eight, independent nations industrializing. You now, as an African Asian country, find yourself in 1945 in a world environment where you're struggling to become from under colonialism, but the people who had you under colonialism still got gun to your head. They still control the oil and the wood and the food. So what you have to do is you have to ascribe and buy in to this IMF World Bank structure that they set up because you don't have weapons. And that's how we got locked into it. Now, when we later, if not this time, the next time, you will see how we're getting unlocked by virtue of the fact that America at this point controlled 50% of all manufactured goods and 50% of the world's economy came through America. So they could squeeze and embargo you. They had weapons so they can kill Lumumba, they can knock off the Shah, they could do it then.
But now America controls less than 9% of the world's economy. So anybody they sanction has no meaning because they don't control it anymore. And not only that, you got other countries like China, India, Pakistan, and others who now have large armies but now have the bomb.
Yes, sir.
And we will get it from our Asian friends. So now things are evening up. And that's why Fidel Castro has never gone under an IMF structural program, and they're still around for 37 years. So you don't have to ascribe them. So you say, well, how did Nigeria and how did these countries get locked into this IMF? Started in 1945 with the white European German having the control of the weapon and control of the natural resources. You had to do what they told you. But now the world being different, the bets are all off. So now let's go down to five. You now want to industrialize. We're Ghana. We want to become industrial, 1947. But if we need oil, who we have to go to? A white man, because he controlled the oil, right? Now we don't have to go to the white, but if you wanted oil, you had to go to European. They control it. You wanted copper. You wanted tin. You had to go to a European at that point. So everybody had to go to the IMF and World Bank, all Asians, all Africans, to get what they needed to make world trade, because who controlled the world trade? At that point, Europeans. So you get stuck with the loan. You had to pay it back. And so what would happen is, as you get the loan, of course, the way they structure it, you never get to pay back. So what is it that you have to now send? We're Ghana. So we get some oil from America. We get some copper from America that they're stealing from another African country. And America says, okay, England, you owe us $2 billion. But what do you have to send in place of $2 billion? What do they want? Do they want paper? What do they want back? Number six. So what do the African and Asian countries get locked into? Sending back to pay back this little loan. So for me to get a few barrels of oil and some copper, the way the GAT, the Agreement of Tariff and Trade, got it locked up in here, I now got to give you half of my corn, half of my wheat, half of my gold, half of my timber. So that's how they get to get the raw materials back again. How they get the labor back again and the technology. So the Europeans had to devise a method where they can still get the labor, raw materials and technology, but not physically be there to conquer you, because they couldn't hold you. So they had the IMF scheme. So now if you want to do trade and get something, you got to come through a European. And they set the terms of the trade on what you must pay them back with. So the African Asian countries then turn around and number six have to pour back into what? Yeah, United States and Europe, gold, rubber, tin, food. So now they're stronger and stronger. You're getting poorer and poorer, but you can't break the cycle because your mind isn't clear and your guns aren't clear. And you don't control the raw materials yet. So now you're feeding. So we caught in the death cycle. That's why Africa, 90% of everything Africa makes, they have to send it to America and Europe. 90% of everything they generate. So you see why America and Europe stay rich and you stay poor. Now United States has another scheme. They say, look, we don't want to put any industry in Africa. But what we'll do is, let's put some industry in South Korea. Let's choose a country that's friendly to us that we can control. Isn't it a coincidence that the United States didn't pour in any industrial development into North Korea? None into North Vietnam? None into China? None into any place they didn't control. So what did they do? They went to Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia. These countries who were coming from under colonialism, like Nigeria and Ghana, weak, and had to ascribe to this thing. Then you get a handful of people in those governments, we'll make you rich. You do this, and we'll set you up in the hell with the rest of the people. So what do they do in number seven? They take in Korea. Say, Korea, we want to build you an automobile industry. Korea has nothing. But we'll take the copper from Zambia. We'll take the iron from Zimbabwe. We'll take the gold from here, and we'll take the oil from everything. So they take all these raw materials from their colonies, and they say to Korea, I'll ship you raw materials, food, and machinery to industrialize Korea. So United States and the West industrialize Korea, using your natural resources, of course, and your technology. They industrialize Malaysia. They industrialize those Asian countries. But what did the Asian countries have to do? Then they say to the bankers, we'll give you loans and credit and currency. So now what you do is you set up South Korea, a little image, mirror image of America, and you deal in currency and you deal in money and all these other things, okay? But now Korea has to ship back to America and the order IMF interest, money, or raw material. So now Ghana is caught in the cycle. It has to send back raw materials. Now, Korea is caught in the cycle. None of you can get out of the cycle because you stuck. But then Castro came along and he functioned without the IMF and World Bank. Now, what happened to number 7? When number 8, that Korea is an independent industrializing nation, and number 4, Ghana, which is the independent, but it's not industrializing yet. Both of them are sending back to United States and IMF and World Bank. What? Money, resources, wood, to keep these countries rich and strong. And because they set the terms, you always fall behind. And what happens in number 10? You default. You default because it's structurally designed to default. When you default, you have to undergo an IMF bailout. And you have to, then you lose your independence. Now let's go to page 2 and see how the IMF works, how you lose your independence, and how you get it back. In number 2, you'll see a series of articles. And they have the where we took them from and the dates. And it says in the IMF, where does the money come from? Upper left-hand corner. 181 member nation IMF, they started as Germans. But later on, they let all countries become members because most of the countries are borrowing. Right. All of us got bank accounts at Citibank or manufactured. You got a bank account, does it mean you have anything to do with the control? No. So out of 180 members of the IMF contribute to the pool of funds that agency has to lend. Most of the countries that join the IMF have no money to lend the IMF. Most of the countries that have money to lend the IMF are listed below. The IMF now has about $200 billion. This is as of 12-19-80-97. It has about $200 billion coming mostly from the richest nation. You notice how they got rich. Who's the biggest contributor? U.S. government, Germany, Japan, Britain, France, and Saudi Arabia. These are the trilateral. Who are the trilateral? U.S., Canada, one side, Japan, the other side, and Western Europe. So these are trilateral. This is their lending agency. Let's go to upper part number 1. It says 1 under IMF. What is the IMF? The organization with all this power was established in Brentwood Conference near the end of World War II. That's in New Hampshire, America. The goal was to build a new international economic order and thus avoid a repetition of the post-Cold War, etc. We're reading only the underlined words. It is headquarters in Washington, D.C., only a few blocks from the White House, which alone makes it suspect in the eyes of some countries. Its top executive includes manufacturing director, this man from France, and the first deputy manager director, this man from America. They report to 24-person international executive board. You can imagine who's on the board. We go up to the upper right-hand corner. The IMF staff members constantly roam the globe, visiting countries and meeting with financial ministers and central banks. It is very important that we put out fires without giving people an incentive to leave matches burning. The organization itself has operated with a high level of secrecy, if not mystery, that has inflamed critics. You don't know what's going on, what deals are made. The IMF officials in their public statements speak in a language that seems purposely oblique, out of professional fear of rattling the financial community. Number 3, down the right-hand side. The IMF has tackled the problem of even bigger economies in the past. Back in 1963, A major industrial nation was scaring off foreign investors who were nervous about its worsening balance of payment and were losing confidence in its overall economic policies. The troubled country borrowed $250 million from the fund that year, another $3 million the next, and the rescue package worked. The currency stabilized and investors' confidence was restored, which was this stumbling country that needed the IMF, the United States. Number four, just list the countries that they made the major bailout to. If we go up to the middle of that page on the left, you see IMF to consider more capital. Where do they get the money from? Washington, December 15th. Seeking to ensure that it has sufficient financial reserve to cope with the crisis, this man requests more capital from the 181 member nations to replenish the fund reserve after the unexpected bailout of Indonesia and South Korea. Appears unlikely, then it appears unlikely to win financial support from the United States. Let's go to the third page. Okay, so to get an overview of what you're dealing with now, you're dealing in a world where you have a set of countries who racially are Germans. England, France, Spain, Portugal, Germany, Russia. Added on Japan and a little add on Canada. Struggling to maintain as much control of the world's economy as they could. Knowing that they started this process about 500 years ago, brought it to its peak about the year 1900. And now in 1945 are rapidly losing control over it. Who are struggling with their institution of the NATO, the UN, and the IMF and World Bank to keep you locked in. In this page, we're going to deal with how they work specifically. And after you look at here, you can apply it to any country in the IMF or World Bank, because this is exactly how they work. This chart was put together from information taken from different sources, financial and otherwise, about Korea at the time they went down. Let's look at it. And we can cover it very shortly. Let's look at the upper left-hand corner. You notice there's an arrow that says bank deposits, pensions, insurance, stock markets, and taxpayers. The IMF gets almost all their money from the governments of the United States, England, France, Germany, and Japan. When the United States government makes a $20 billion contribution to the IMF, where did the money come from? Your tax revenues. When Citibank manufactures Hanover, when your New York City pension plan and the New York State pension plan, all those tens of billions of dollars, that's why you can't touch your money till you're 65, because they're playing with it. All your pension money, these tens of billions of dollars, are taken up by these financial investors, Germans. And where do they put? IMF. Where do they go? They go to loan these companies. Your pension money. That's where the power of the money is coming from, the little person. But you think, and I think, all these great Milliken and all these Rubin, these guys are rich and stuff. They are using your pension money. That's where your money is coming from. So when you see up in there, Europe 35% of the, Japan 50%, the US 15%, this represents the rough percentage in which these countries invested into Korea. This is specific for Korea. But regardless of whether it's Korea, Malaysia, Indonesia, when you turn on the TV and you hear them in Congress fighting over whether or not to give $30 billion to the IMF, so that the IMF can take the $30 billion and lend it to somebody, it's your tax dollars. So therefore, they can't fix your roads, they close down the schools, et cetera, et cetera. You go to get your pension fund, and all of a sudden, you only can get 60 cents on the dollar. You can't touch your Social Security. That's why they want to take all your Social Security, put it in the stock market, so they can legally steal it. These are the master thieves that you live with. This is them. I mean, this is their record. This is how they function. So you understand when we look and some of us say, look how powerful these people are. They take your money. Now they got your pension money. Citibank took your pension money, and this Metropolitan Prudential, the other day, was one of the Prudential was, they lost $10 billion. They couldn't find it. The government said pay back four. Okay, they now take your money, and they now lend it primarily not to the government of South Korea, but to the private businesses in South Korea, to the private banks, to the private. So when you look at this upper strip, you notice that in the Korea it says government, private banks, and private companies, correct? Mm-hmm. Now, in that slit, you notice you see short-term interest? It's less than 30 days. And you notice long-term loan? Greater than 90. Now, if you look on the short-term loan, the Korean government didn't borrow a dime for short-term loan. But look on the short-term loan, the private banks of Korea borrow $55 billion. And the private company borrow $26 billion. So who owes the money? The private companies. Go down there, look at the long-term loan. The Korean government only got $9 billion. But the private banks took $44 billion and $18 billion. So your money, your tax dollars, your pension are going to private companies in these countries. Now what happens? Let's go down below. You notice that as these companies function, they will send back interest or money to Europe, Japan, US, IMF. They funnel it back. What do they use this money that they got for? To buy raw materials. So United States says to South Korea, I'll give you $5 billion at 10% interest. Korea takes the $5 billion and buys the oil back from United States. Buy back the copper and stuff while United States is stealing it from somebody. Now you see how they get rich. Meanwhile, Korea, everything is humming along. Now for the last 20 or 30 years, Korea, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, and Japan, and America, and Europe, they all are trading, they all are part of this credit scheme. In other words, if somebody told you tomorrow, turn in all your credit cards, you going out, right? Because the agreement was that as long as I will use it as long as we keep going back and forth. But if you pull my credit card, you destroy me. Now, United States has $3 trillion in debt. The United States owes $3 trillion in treasury notes. $1.2 trillion is owned by foreigners. If Japan, China, Germany pulled their money from the United States, this country would collapse. So in this whole scheme, any one country who pulls something to support, the country collapses. So this country will financially collapse if Japan decides to call in its $333 billion. And Germany says, I want my $200 billion. So what did they do? So North Korea, Korea is sending back the money. Everything is fine. They're buying the raw materials. The only problem is Asia is beginning to industrialize and become competitive with United States and Europe. They don't want that. So what do you think they're going to do? What they do, let's look in the upper right-hand corner. All of around July, for some reason, under the market phase, they got it all worked out. First you pull a guy from the car, first you identify him as a black man. You stop him, the next phase you pull him out the car. The fourth phase you beat him to death. They're phases. So the IMF got their phases. Now let's go to the upper right-hand corner and you'll see what they call a market phase. They made plenty of money out of Asia. Things are humming good. What they are industrializing, they're becoming too competitive. They're making airplanes and stuff. We got to stop that development. So what do they do under the market phase? They withdraw the credit from Korea and Asia. They withdraw the loans. They withdraw the stock. So in other words, they say to Korea, look, you owe us $70 billion.
But we, in this scheme, we allow you to pay $4 billion a year. But they only can pay $4 billion as long as they keep getting credit and giving back and forth, right? Like your credit card. You must be able to use the credit card, and when things get tight, you use credit from here to pay this one, right? So this is what these countries do. The United States is in so much debt that they use credit back and forth. In fact, United States doesn't earn enough in the world market to pay for half of what you got. So for instance, United States earns enough in a year to pay for a certain amount of oil. It cannot afford the other 50% of oil. So what it does, it floats treasury notes. And in these treasury notes that you buy up, they use the treasury note every year to get the money they need to buy the oil. So United States is financing on credit half of everything that comes in this country. This is the biggest credit addict. Korea and these countries are in the same scheme. So what these Europeans did, the English, America, Western Europe, and Japan, they withdrew credit from South Korea, Malaysia, and Thailand. They stopped investing in the stock market. They stopped buying treasury notes. And what happened to the currency? Drop. What happened to their stock market? Drop. And because the currency and stock market drop, and they're no longer giving credit to them, now North Korea cannot finance its debt. So then they say you're now in default. Somebody comes to you again and say to you, tomorrow, cancel all your credit cards. But you know you need the credit cards to live off of. You're not going to make it. If the world came to the United States tomorrow and said, we're buying no more treasury notes, if United States didn't go to war to get what it wanted, you would, the price of gasoline, everything would almost go up four times. So what happened was Korea found itself, as an example, in this acute situation where they can't get any more credit to buy what they need, and they can't afford to pay their debt. So what do the United States and them do? You get no more oil. You get no more wood. You get no more anything. You get nothing. So they cut off the flow of raw materials. It's as if the OPEC said, we're cutting America all off from oil. Okay, so they put these Asian countries in this acute crisis. And then they said to them, okay, you owe me. But what I will do is, I have a special thing for you. But before I tell you this thing, what do the South Koreans do? What they tried to do to save themselves is they rushed and tried to issue their own bond to raise money. But the people who can afford to buy this bond for them to raise money are the same ones who withdrew it. So nobody would buy the bond. So Korea could not save itself on the international market. So when you see under Korea, it says junk bond status. When Korea went to float the money, the IMF said nobody's taking it, it was junk bond. So what happened was, you go that, see that big square down the middle? So you got the market phase is when they collapse your economy by withdrawing the money and credit and your currency drop, everything drops. That's why if you're a country and you allow yourself to establish a stock market with currency, and you hook into the Wall Street and these stock exchange, they can collapse your country because you agree to play by these rules. So United States says, look, I tell you what, because everything you can't afford to pay for this, I'll take it back. I'll buy this industry, I'll take this and this and this, but for a fifth of the value, a sixth of the value, an eighth of the value. Vietnam, China, Cuba, a large number of African countries, Iran and Asian countries no longer are part of this system. They're not part of the loan shark system. That's why they're not going to get caught. And what does the IMF say to you now? It's like I come back and we pull your credit card and I said, I'm going to take your Mercedes for $5,000, but you said the thing is worth $50, but you can't pay five or nothing. I want your stereo set. It's $200, I give you 10. So now United States, they pull out their portfolio. These countries now look at Korea, Malaysia, and them, and everybody's looking at what's the best industry to buy for nothing. So what does the IMF say? Let's look at the IMF private bank bailout. And this is exactly what they do to you each and every time. To squeeze it in loan shark. You don't pay the money, I break your leg. Let's take a look at number one. Now that you no longer can afford to pay me $50 billion at 5% interest, what I'm going to do is take that $50 billion and I'm going to roll it over. And now give you a new loan, but at 10%. Right? Okay. But who owes most of the loan? Private or government? But can the private pay back? So when they roll it over, who did they roll it over and reissue the note to? Who? The government. So the private industries done borrowed up the $100 billion. They can't pay back. So United States tells the South Korean government, we're going to make you responsible for the $100 billion. So they roll over the loan, twice the interest, but now instead of the private businesses assuming the loan, the government assumes it. Now where's the government going to get the money from to pay back? From who? The tax people, the payers. So in order to pay back the money the private business squandered, the government now is assuming the whole loan. But if you're going to assume the loan, can you equally pay back the loan and provide for your people? Okay, before we read this, what do you think is required of the IMF on you? What do you have to do to your education on spending? What you have to do to your building of your public service? What do you have to do with people working? And what you doing with what you're going to do with people's pension? What you going to do with taxes? What you going to do with the subsidy on food and oil? In other words, you saw what happened in Indonesia? The place exploded. You can't tell people they can't have cooking. What would you do if you now had to turn around and spend $5 a gallon for gas? $3 for a loaf of bread, $5 for milk. So when the people are sitting there and can't get cooking oil, I mean can't get bread, eggs, the place is going up. And in South Korea, they were able to hold it at this point. Indonesia just exploded. So what do they say now? And now that you're under this tremendous budget, you know that private industry that took the loan? It's now valued, it was valued at $100 billion because they devaluated your currency, that now corporation is worth $10 billion. Your Mercedes went from $50,000 the next day to $5,000, and he takes it away. So now the American businesses can go over to these Asian countries and buy up the steel mill and the aluminum and the car factories for a fraction of it. They strip them clean. In all of these economies, the industrial base is squeezed down to nothing. The poverty is skyrocketing and all this. So let's look at what they say. Number one, on South Korea particularly, the financial advisor for the government of South Korea comes from Goldman Sachs Securities. He's going to tell the South Korean, see, they're going to take this money and they're going to give your tax dollars to South Korea. But this guy from Goldman Sachs is going to tell the Korean government how to spend the money. Second, the government regulatory agency. They're going past the finance ministry. They wipe that out. The regulatory agency is J.P. Morgan Investment Bailout. That's who's running South Korea. Number three, the short-term loans are converted to long-term loans roll over as government bonds with high percent interest guaranteed by the Korean taxpayers. Government deals only with the IMF. Korea was trying to work out something. Japan was trying to come in to save it. Hong Kong was coming in to save it. In China, they tried. But the United States told South Korea, you can't deal with these people. You must deal with us, because if you don't deal with us, how are we going to keep you in the scheme? These are the conditions. Now you understand why they got to work in secret and why governments refuse to work with it. Government subsidy on food, fuel, and housing go down. Government civil service, they destroy your civil service. Unemployment skyrocket. You're the one sitting there with people rioting and trying to burn down the place. That's why United States historically has made these death squads in each of these countries so that they can kill the people as needed when this scheme blows up on them. No physical improvement of infrastructure. Taxes go up, inflation goes down, close failing banks and companies. Sell domestic banks, companies to foreign investors and foreign subsidiaries. They own your country. That's the price Korea paid for trying to industrialize and having nothing. Did they think that somebody gonna give them something? Bank and companies must downsize and push up the employment. You must open all domestic markets to all form of foreign investment and imports. And the loan money they gave to Korea, where does it go? Loan monies to repay foreign banks and companies. So after they give Korea the $10 billion thing, who does it go to bail out? Well, who owns the money? Citibank, Chase, Deutsche Bank of Germany, the Japan. So the money that they take from your IMF, that you took your tax dollars, they give it to the South Korean government, who transfers it back and never left America. So on the books, South Korea owns it, and the taxpayers in South Korea are going to pay by dying, but these people do it. It's a bailout. Now, if you look on this page, in the upper left-hand corner, you see one of the reasons why they want to educate you. The IMF fund employs more than 1,000 PhDs. So go up to Harvard, get your PhD in economics, and you won't know what's going on. Education is to train you. You go get your PhD from economics, PhD from Harvard or Yale, in economy, many of whom constantly travel the globe looking for trouble in the making. Are they looking for opportunities? How they gonna do it? Bribing your ministers, etc., etc., etc. They issue reports praising both Thailand and South Korea for good, strong macroeconomic. Follow the Asian countries. This is the way to do it. Only months before, those countries were pleading for and got IMF bailout. So you down the drain. I mean, you believe that they came with their suits and their tie. They were white. They had PhDs and all of the trappings that go along with it. And you fell for it. And it says here, more broadly, South Korea, its department stores packed with high technology goods and shoppers, its government ministries, thick with PhDs from American universities. See, they sold it all. That's why when you put in a new finance minister of Vietnam, said, no, we can't get involved in this scheme. And then the IMF said, the new finance minister of Vietnam, he wasn't properly educated. He doesn't know about the economics because he didn't go to school here. What I'm going to read you here is from an article from Buchanan. And it says, if Reuben had a share of the honor, he'll resign. Now, in order to get more money, in order for the IMF to get more money, they're trying to get Congress to give them a quick $20 billion, your tax dollars. That $20 billion is going to go to South Korea. South Korea, it'll never make South Korea. The $20 billion is going to be put on the books for South Korean government to pay back. But the money is going to be sent to Morgan, Chase, Citibank to bail out the bank. So you know why the bailout is, right? Do you understand? The bailout is to bail out American banks. You understand that? So when Prudential, MetLife, Citibank, and the rest of them, they invest in these countries, they make big money, the countries falter, they pull the money,
And then what they do, they go to the IMF and say, give the money to them to bail me out. That's what it is, it's a bailout. So now the people, the senators in the United States are saying they don't want to give any more money to bail out these black people. So look at what Buchanan Shea, and I read you two little paragraphs from it to illustrate how the system works. Buchanan, yeah, he's not one of their favorite sons. He beats them up bad. Anyhow, they're talking about this whole IMF scheme. And they're talking about Mexico defaulting. Rubin, who is the Secretary of Treasury at this point. You see? And what they're saying is, had Mexico defaulted, Rubin was history. Wall Street had to be bailed out. Well, you know, that's why the loans are there. They're loans to these IMF, and then the money comes right back to the banks and insurance companies. That's who you're bailing out. Where did Rubin get the cash from to pay out the bailout? Government didn't give it to him. His key resource was the Treasury's $40 billion. This $40 billion is in the deposit of the exchange stabilization fund. They have a fund in the Treasury Department with $40 billion in it. It's called Exchange Stabilization Fund, set up in 1933 to stabilize the money. Which Rubin used for the bailout. What about the stabilization fund? The stabilization fund is under the control of the U.S. Treasury. Just a little old bank account sitting on the side. When you want to take money out of here, the Secretary of the Treasury writes a check. No authorization from Congress. Nobody knows. All he does is take the money, write the check. He hands it to the President of the United States. Clinton signs it. Boom, $20 billion gone. You know where this money came from? Your tax dollars over the last 10 years. So even when Congress does not issue in the appropriation the $20 billion to the IMF, right now in Congress, the IMF is trying to get Congress to give $20 billion of your tax dollars to the IMF so the IMF can give it to South Korea to give it back to Citibank. Even though Congress won't allocate it, Secretary of Treasury Rubin, rubber stamped by Clinton, they're taking out the money from here, and they don't have to account for it. In other words, they don't have to go any place and ask permission. They set it up so that the Secretary of the Treasury with the President could just spend the money as he wants. That's how they're funding it. This is how your government works. When they tell you about welfare this and welfare, this is how it functions. So what we have here basically is an overview of this scheme you call an IMF and World Bank. What is happening to it? It is slowly disintegrating. And people ask, what you're talking about? We have to understand that it was only been put in existence since 1945. It's new. And what were the Europeans using before they had the IMF? Plain colonialism. They didn't need the World Bank and IMF. But because groups of countries are not tapping into it, this bank system gradually runs down. The scheme putters out. Because you need the constant feeding in. And so now many of the Asian countries are now questioning whether they should go back. China, Vietnam are not participating. Iran and those Asian countries are not participating. Many of the African countries are beginning to not participate. And the African countries are now saying that there must be a change. What I want to do as we finish is just tail in on a little bit of Africa, how it touches base. And what I'm going to do is just read you from a few paragraphs from an article from the New York Times, June 7th, 1998, and it says, "At what cost?" And it's Bob Herbert. It has a nice name, the African Growth and Opportunity Act, and a clever slogan, trade but not aid. But a bill now before Congress is in fact an enormous benefit package for the thriving multinational corporations and a threat to the sovereignty of the sub-Saharan nations that sponsors of the bill want to help. You know why, right? You see the scheme. Okay, so they can't fool you anymore. Anytime you see the IMF and World Bank, and anytime you see something coming out the U.S. government, you know what it's about. The bill narrowly passed the House in March. This is the bill Clinton took over, where it was introduced and pushed hard by Representative Philip Crane, an Illinois Republican who has referred to some developing African countries and their leaders as retards. A spokesman told me on Friday that the congressman had no intent to offend anyone. The sponsor of the bill in the Senate, which has yet to vote on the measure, so it hasn't passed. So the bill, HRA, whatever they call it, has passed the House, passed. Senate, it didn't come up yet, so it's not an official bill yet. The Senate, the sponsor in the Senate, which has yet to vote on the measure, is Richard Lugar, an Indiana Republican. The bill has the strong backing of the Clinton administration, as well as such giant corporations as Texaco, Coca-Cola, and Kmart. The aim of the bill is to liberalize trade between the U.S. and Africa. What is it that Africa got they want? But they can't directly steal it anymore, right? And that many of the African countries are dropping out of the IMF. So you gotta think of another scheme to dig it out. That's what it is. It would mean, among other things, to allow duty-free and quota-free exports to the United States for 10 years. Support the creation of a U.S. sub-Saharan free trade agreement and the encouragement of the overseas private investment corporation, taking some of your tax dollars to fund these big industries to do business in Africa, to set up a fund to stimulate private development in Africa. But the bill also makes some demands. The participating countries would have to adhere to a harsh and often humane requirement of the who? IMF. That's why Mandela and the African countries told Clinton the bill is unacceptable. They told him point blank. So any of us who worried about, oh, they're going to get Africa again, they told him we're not dealing with the bill. The bill only allocates $800 million to 50 African countries. What you going to do with $800 million? Israel gets $5 billion a year from the U.S.
Free.
To become the ally to U.S. Egypt gets $3 billion a year to keep the Suez Canal open for America. Suez Canal closed, half of all the oil and food and wood coming to Europe will be shut off. Suez Canal is critical to the West. That's why Egypt gets this. So you know 800 men is a joke. They told them so. Well, who's doing it? They said the white people didn't even want to pass it here, and the Senate said they're not going to pass it. In fact, they said they may not even take it up. We are not dealing with you black people. They told you that. Now, of course, Jesse Jackson, the rest of them, they don't know anything about this. So now we have to undergo a harsh IMF budget. You see what's going to happen to you? They're going to strangle you to death. To death. Thus, these undeveloped and often very poor countries would have to undergo a radical economic restructuring that would include its corporate taxes, reduction to government spending, privatization of some of the most valuable assets. So you want to now come in and let them buy up your mines, your forests, your harbors, your oil wells, and the like, with the multinational and other wealthy investors ready to snap up everything. You might as well burn it down to give it to them. You understand what the bill is about? The Africans understand it, but some of us don't understand it. So we're worrying about whether or not the white man is going to get you. Ask Mobutu that. What does this mean to the people on the ground in these countries? Put it that the IMF structural adjustment program are already underway in some African countries, and studies of this program have shown disturbing effect, and it goes on and on and on. From the point of view of the IMF and the multinational, this is excellent economic sense to sell your country to them for nothing, because we are too stupid to know that this person is coming to rip you. You don't need United States.
Thank you.
The trade bill also requires participating countries to join the World Trade Organization. The World Trade Organization supplants GATT. It was set up by white, the seven white countries. It's centered in Geneva. The white man wrote all the rules. Back to the same thing. Okay, you know why? Because you no longer want to... African agents no longer want to participate in the GATT. They no longer want to participate in the IMF. They're dropping out. So now they're going to come up with a World Trade Organization, another scheme.
Does that include Japan?
Pardon me?
Does that include Japan and the refusal?
The trilateral countries are the countries who have had colonies. They are your poor countries. It is the United States and Canada. It is Western Europe, and the third part is Japan. Japan is a rock. It has nothing. It had colonies, so it joined with these two to band together as a trilateral to collectivize the energy to rip your guts. Right? So, of course, the trilateral is part of the group against you. Because when this Africa bill goes through and the IMF money comes through, whose money is the IMF money? These three people. The trade bill also requires participating countries to join the World Trade Organization, even though many African countries have chosen not to join, because they know what the scheme is. The Organization for Economic Development and Support of the World Trade, that's the white Europeans, have reported that sub-Saharan countries would be a loser under the World Trade Organization rules, because countries that import more food, it goes on. 4 out of 10 countries, and it goes on, and attempts to amend the bill to modify the most onerous portions have been beaten back. So the white man said, we ain't taking nothing out of it. President Mandela of South Africa has characterized the bill as non-acceptable. At least he has said something correct since he's been there. And the reason that I say that is because most of our women and children are still on reservations. Whites got all the mines, they got all the food, they got everything. You haven't restored anything to the women and children. But most sub-Saharan leaders faced with desperate, and it goes on. What I'd like to do is to conclude briefly with an analysis of the trip that Clinton took to Africa. We have 20 minutes?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Take your time.
He visited Ghana, Uganda, Rwanda, South Africa,
Botswana, and Senegal. It took them 12 days, right? You need one day to fly to Africa, one day to fly back. You need 3 days to fly within Africa. So 5 days travel. So he's now got to spend 7 days visiting 6 countries. So he flies into Ghana, 6 hours. Ghana is not important in the itinerary of Clinton. He flies into Uganda and he stays 1.5 days. He spends 3 hours in Rwanda. He spends a little less than a day in South Africa. He spends a day or so in Botswana, and Senegal is just to stay to the airport and go. So obviously Senegal, Rwanda, Botswana, South Africa is not important. What's important? What is happening in Uganda that Clinton was told to get over there? A conference, right? Who sponsored the conference? These 17 countries, Central African countries, sponsored a conference. The conference was sponsored by 17 Central African countries. The leading countries are the Congo, Uganda, and Rwanda. Who attended the conference? 50 ministers from every country in Africa. Chinese, Japanese, Koreans, Indians, Pakistan, Iran. What's happening? Why are all of these countries coming to this conference of African people? Is there something happening here that we don't know about, we weren't told about? Clinton was told by the business establishment, you must attend this conference in Uganda. Something is happening here. What is happening? What is it that these 17 Central African countries have that the United States and the world needs? Minerals. The minerals that come from the lower two-thirds of Africa, 90% of all known minerals in the world come there. If most of the minerals that you need, like cobalt, zinc, copper, platinum, they're located in different countries, but they're mainly in the Congo, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Angola, Rwanda, Mozambique, and some in South Africa. Most of the minerals at this point come through Africa through a railroad system that passed through South Africa. That's the way they set it up. It is calculated that if the minerals do not leave Africa, that Western Europe will economically collapse in 6 months. Japan, 6 months. United States, less than a year. You can't make a computer, a fax machine, a rocket. You can forget it. So that means that those or who controls the natural resources are what? They are the key players in the world's what? Economy. See, you play with the stock and bonds, give me some cobalt, some diamond, some nickel to make the world one. Who used to control these? You used to have to come to the United States and England. But who now controls it? Africans. No, but let us go on to try to answer the question, do we hopefully control it?
Thank you, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
When South Africa was here, South Africa was running border raids across the South African and destroying everything in Angola, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Zambia, and Mozambique. Kept everything destabilized, right?
Yes, sir.
Mobutu, with the West, had a war going into what's keeping Congo Brazzaville under the French, had a war going into Sudan, had a war going into Uganda, was an integral part of Rwanda. Could we have killed a million in less than 6 months? Or what germ warfare or European genocidal policy was put in Rwanda? Let us not believe that we killed all those people. They had a war going in, you know, Savimbi in Angola, right?
Yes, sir.
So two-thirds of Africa was kept in a virtual state of war. Now, if you were in a state of war, you can't get together. Plus, they have stripped your country because the Germans control one-fifth of the Congo, and they were stripping everything they could.
Yes, sir.
So we were in pretty bad shape. Angola was the only country in the southern African region that could challenge South Africa because Angola had oil. And with oil, you can buy what you want. So Angola, because of its population and the oil, was a threat to South Africa because they could buy tanks, airplanes. So United States and the West policy was to have South Africa constantly strike Angola from the south, and Savimbi would come from the Congo and strike them from the north and keep Angola destabilized. When they had the civil war in Angola and a group got in that wasn't favorable to the United States, they really pushed in against them. Angola was almost toppled. The Russians did not help Angola.
That's right.
For some reason, the OAU didn't help Angola. And Nigeria didn't help Angola. Who helped? Chupa came in, stabilized the situation with weapons, with 50,000 plus troops, with tanks, airplanes, blah, 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 et cetera, right? In 1990, they had a big war in the southern part of the Congo, Angola, and Lambe shows you the picture.
Yes.
Kunta Kona Valley is when the African Angolan and the African Cuban destroyed 100,000 men of the best white army they could put there. That's South Africa, that's Israel, that's France, a bit their best. We destroyed them. When we destroyed them, they were going to push into South Africa.
Yes, sir.
But America and them said to Angola and Cuba, can we make a deal? And they said, okay. The agreement was that Angola and Cuba would not push into South Africa, but the condition was South Africa had to release Namibia on the road of independence.
Yes.
That's how Namibia got independent.
That's right.
And that South Africa had to do what to all political prisoners? That's how Mandela and everybody got out. They didn't get out because of sanctions or because of your demonstration. It's because of disagreement. And that South Africa had to be put on the road of independence. That's how they got. So what they did was they stopped the whites from all of these countries. All of a sudden were brought to a state of peace. So once when you stop fighting, you can talk. But meanwhile, you have this problem here. So when you first heard of Kabila moving across. Now you know that the United States and NATO intervened about 3 or 4 times to stabilize Mobutu. But when you heard them moving, there was no NATO intervention. Then the United States says that the Congolese troops were not winning the war on their own, they had help. That was to admit that they couldn't do it on their own, and then they held back. Because that was an admission that the Congolese troops were getting help, right? So what they found out later, that what troops combined to get rid of Mobutu? Angola, troops, tanks, planes. Uganda pushed in, troops, tanks, planes. 17 countries pooled their resources to get rid of Mobutu. Africans were working on a pan-African relationship. Who supported this move? Eritrea, Ethiopia, Southern Sudan, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Tanzania, and Uganda, and Angola, and Congo. The Africans were on the move. That's why they didn't intervene, because they knew what was going to happen. Because the whites already were destroyed here, and you know what we did to them up in Somalia. They knew they could not intervene against that powerful military force, and they swept them out. It is these 17 countries that collectivized their energies to get rid of Mobutu are now in a regional economic bloc. And it is these 17 countries who are regional economic bloc who call the conference. They say they're no longer Francophone or Frenchmen. They're no longer Anglophone. They're Bantuphone. Okay? And as a result of this military victory, with these countries pooling their resources, that's why these natural resources are under your control. Kabila has traveled to Switzerland, probably to work out something with the Swiss to get back some of the money from Mobutu.
Yes, ma'am.
He has been to Japan, China, Korea, making their arrangement. But he has not gone to Western Europe. He has not gone to America.
Right.
So now America's complaining that they can't establish a relationship with him. But why is it critical? Because if you want cobalt for your jet engines, you want diamonds, you got to deal with them. But now you must come to Africa under the terms of these countries. So Clinton was sent there specifically to go there to beg. Okay, he was begging. Because they don't have to deal with them, because whatever you need in the world, you can get from other people.
Yes, sir.
But United States could not have you see that Clinton was sent just to Uganda. So they had to make it sound as if he was on this African tour. You know how they disguise it? And so he can drop into Angola, Uganda, and try to check out what's happening. But of course they had to load up his thing with all these black folks, wrangle and wrestle them, the smoke screen.
Yes,
ma'am.
So it is these two events. Cuba was the pivotal country to get Angola, the dominant military force here, which then led to this additional force to do this. And if you listen to the foreign minister of Angola and Congo and the rest of them, you will see why these are under their country. So now, as we conclude, you now have Angola with about 250,000 men under arms. The Congo said they're going to put 250,000 men under arms. Ethiopia, whatever they have, 50,000 men under arms. Nigeria, about 200,000 men under arms. And Egypt has about 200,000 men under arms. Now, I don't know about South Africa, because they're still under white control, so I don't count them. So you can see we're beginning to be well-armed.
Yes.
So there should be no more interventions in it. And how do you know? It's because the foreign minister of Congo told you at the UN that they are not going to allow Savimbi to operate. They're going to get him.
Yes, sir.
5,000 troops from Angola crossed the Congo and stopped the civil war in Congo-Brazzaville. Nigeria, with Ghana, sent in troops to stop the civil war in Liberia and to stop the civil war in Sierra Leone. So what you're now having is African regional power taking care of their own problems. And now they begin to regionalize along economic blocks so that they're first trading among themselves, and they're working with the rest of the world, and they primarily bypass the United States and the World Bank.
Good.
And later on another time, we'll show you the articles where the IMF is going to suspend the Congo from the IMF because they want the Congo to pay them $14 billion that Mobutu and they stole.
Yeah.
And Kabila and them already said, look, when you find the money that you stole with Mobutu in your banks, you give it to us.
and we'll give you back some. And Kabila wants to know, where are all the roads and stuff that you this money that you loaned with him? Where? Show me. So what they have done is this. Congo, Rwanda, and Uganda are now in a road building project. And what they're doing now is the people are going to build the roads. They're going to hire, they're going to take the local people, they say in conjunction with the chiefs, and they're going to rebuild the roads. They're going to give the people axes, picks, shovels, and they're going to pay them. So they're going to rebuild the road system without a dime from the IMF. So this is how they're beginning to break the link. And with you controlling the natural resources, you no longer have to come to anybody for anything. And the world has radically changed. And this is where we are progressing and we are moving. And these are some of the basic facts and understanding that we have to assess where we're going. And when you listen and you hear that Nigeria is beginning to build a pipeline all across West Africa, Togo, Benin, Ghana, Ivory Coast. And what it's going to do is going to make it possible for you to begin to industrialize. And here, the New York Times, they talk about Nigeria. With all of the internal problems, and they're talking about Nigeria, the regional power that will help to bring a regional economic order to that part of the world. We got problems, we're going to work it out. But we got people, we got natural resources, we got oil and fuel. So when they lay down that pipeline across West Africa and they start the industrial process, Nigeria is richer than South Africa. It's just that in South Africa, they developed it. They just didn't even touch what's in Nigeria. So what's coming is the fact now that Nigeria has replaced the English and the Americans. And I'm going to read you just one short paragraph from here. And it says here, the international West Africa trembles with Nigeria. 2 minutes and we're finished. The international commitment. No fewer than 7 African head of states rushed to Nigeria when Abacha died. South Africa and Egypt may have more of a powerful army, but no African, now this is from the white man. Okay? This is their assessment. And you assume that this is they want to be as negative as they could. South Africa and Egypt may have a more powerful army but no African country is more involved in the security arrangement in the surrounding regions than Nigeria. South Africa may have a high level industrialization and a teeny oil state of Libya and Gabon, much higher per capita income, but no African country's economic wealth is more vital to its neighbors. Nigeria is the engine. You destabilize and break it up, we all going to be in trouble in Africa, West Africa. It has to stay as a unit, but they got to work it out among themselves, how it's going to be run. But it, as a nation state with the power to do what it has to do in West Africa, economically, militarily, and the world, it has to stay intact. Oil-rich Nigeria can submerge its neighbors in economic woes or flood it when it is flush. It's the world's 7th oil producer and the United States' largest trading partner. Only African countries whose sudden disappearance from the map would cause more than a momentary ripple on an international scale. They're saying Nigeria is important to the world. 105 million people, large military, and a hyperactive foreign policy that many would quibble with America's self-designation. The president of Sierra Leone, 1,000 miles from Nigeria, west of Nigeria, was overrun in a coup 13 months ago. I took this out the Times today. Were overrun in a coup 13 months ago by rural rebels, invaded the capital, Freetown, looting and burning all in its path. Washington quickly sent Marines to evacuate Western residents, saving them from the mayhem and doing nothing to help the country. The United Nations, likewise, took no action. The only country that provided willing and able to help out the flawless nation was Nigeria. Stabilize it. General Abacha sent warships to blockade. The rebels blockade the rebels and trying to starve the economy, war planes to bomb the insurrection. Well, when all of that did not work, he mounted an intervention force. Nigerians lost troops, but he restored the order and stability. Sierra Leone president, etc., went on to say, there's going to be no change in the foreign policy of Nigeria, according to the new president. When there is trouble in our region, this is Akubaka, whatever his name, the brother, Akubaka. He says, when there is trouble in our region, we will be there. Because to go absent would mean letting the fire spread. And it goes on and on and on and on. And this is what we're looking at. We are beginning to see Africa strong, armies, economics, and playing a position in the world, but they can't let you know that. They can't let you know how profound the changes have been in the IMF, the World Bank economy, the whole world. And this is where we are at this particular point. So we're going to conclude here.
Brother took us to school, didn't he?
Yes.
Yusuf, we don't need anybody else, do we?
No.
No, that was an inside joke. Sisters and brothers, let's thank Dr. Lewis. And we have to welcome his beautiful, hard-working wife, Sister Mary Lewis, and the family. And the family. This, whenever we need Dr. Ben, this is who we have to go through to get Dr. Ben. And in speaking about Dr. Ben, Dr. Lewis, I don't believe that information you brought us.
I don't.
Well, let me just say it again. Brother Nooney, you go past Dr. Ben's house in the morning by 8 or 9. You talk with him, you take the walk, and you find out for yourself.
But, I mean, you've been there. I mean,
I'm telling you.
You remember, even before the brother spoke, you remember what I said about him? He takes care of Dr. Ben. And I know that he was climbing a wall. I know, because he knows Dr. Ben better than anyone else. And what he said here goes to what Baba Shin has always said. The Creator does not work in a mysterious way. I mean,
that's where he is. Doc has made all the necessary changes, and like I said, you can go anyone you can talk to.
No, it's wonderful. I mean, it's really wonderful. Because, I mean, I personally spoke to Dr. Ben, and he dismissed me, as you well know. So, you know, that was very, very good information, very good news. And I'm sure the Creator visited with him.
Yeah, we can take a few questions, give it 10 minutes or so.
Yeah, just the reason why Dr. Lewis had to work today too, and he has to go back to the city. So, two quick questions. He will be back here for part two.
Okay.
So you don't have to worry. If you see the flyer, he'll be back here for part two. The first question.
Yeah.
Oh. Excuse me.
It took, 2 years before it started balancing out itself? And are you and anyone else within your realm setting up a think tank to inform or update the African government as an economic structure within the world market?
Well, if you go to the second question, I don't. What we need to do here is to get together as we do like we have here and get information and exchange it, so that we could better be informed on what is happening, so that we'll be in a better position to make certain decisions on what we should do here, what projects we can do on the continent, whether we should hook up, and what activities we have to go on. The other part of the question is, if the people in the Congo, Ethiopia, if they are smart enough, which we know they are, they have already put together their armies, their security, their agriculture, they already put their people to work. So I think there's very little
that we could basically add to their understanding of how to develop a country because they're doing it. It doesn't mean that we can contribute, but they're already practicing what we are talking about in terms of nation building. Now, what was the other one about Japan?
They had the problem in the stock market, and they said 2 years wasn't balanced or whatever it was.
What the Japanese?
So they have all this money invested in America. Why couldn't they just retrieve some or whatever to balance themselves out?
Because the whole system works on you helping, trading with each other. What if the Japanese...